Welcome to Inside Alzheimer's Research, brought to you by Cure Alzheimer's Fund. We usually call this program Inside the Alzheimer's Lab, but today we're not going to be talking about research. We're going to be talking about, at least directly, we're going to be talking about Cure Alzheimer's Fund and what they do in Washington, D.C. to advocate for more and better research. And with me are two distinguished guests from Cure Alzheimer's Fund. We'll be talking in just a minute about who they are and what they do. This program is brought to you by Cure Alzheimer's Fund 4 times a year to explain what we do and why you should support us. So thank you again for watching. My name is David Shank. I'm senior advisor to Cure Alzheimer's Fund. I'm also author of the book, The Forgetting. So now to my guest, Tim Armour. To my far left is CEO and president of Cure Alzheimer's Fund. That speaks for itself. Phil Cronin is senior advisor to Cure Alzheimer's Fund. Did I say that right? CEO and president. Okay, Phil is senior advisor for public policy to Cure Alzheimer's Fund, and we're both senior advisors. We were having a discussion before we went on camera about who outranks the other, and I think we're going to punt that to you. You can decide and maybe vote on Facebook as the program continues. So welcome both of you. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
This is a treat to not get into technical scientific research, although I like doing that. It's going to be a treat to not do that for once. So Tim, first to you. I think the first and most obvious question is, people already know us as a science research organization. I think are pretty impressed with us in the science, rightfully so, the research that we do. They probably don't know us as an advocacy organization. So talk a little bit about how one fits into the other, and then we'll go from there.
Thanks, David. I think the big picture is we can't do it alone. We are a good, efficient, very focused, targeted research organization that finds really good researchers with innovative proof of concept type of research. But we need partners to bring that research to market, essentially. The government is the only body out there with the scale that can provide the kind of resources that support basic research in general, which we can build on, and then they can pick it up and move it further down the pipeline towards actual drug development. So we have a very important, critical role to fill, but so do other players in this drama, including a lot of the people who are watching today.
And effectively, as people are going to find out when we get into the details, we really couldn't be doing the research we're doing without this public policy role. They really
fit
hand in hand. So before we get into those details, I understand you brought a video along that kind of sets up what we do. Do you want to tell us what that video
is? I do. We do have a video, and this is building on the theme that 10 years ago, Cure Alzheimer's Fund started. It was begun by Jeff and Jackie Morby, at that point living in Pittsburgh, and they saw the terrible danger of this disease, both in terms of human suffering and in economic destruction to our country and abroad. They wanted to do something about it. So they brought on board a couple of other families, Henry McCants and his family, Phyllis Rappaport and her family. They decided to form a foundation to try to do something about this. This is about 10 years ago. At the same time, what was going on in the federal government was Senator Ed Markey, then a congressman from Massachusetts, and Congressman Jim Smith from New Jersey, got together and agreed that Alzheimer's was an important and a dangerous enough effect in the United States to develop a task force, a congressional task force on Alzheimer's, and to try to do something about this through Congress. So simultaneously, and kind of unknowing each other 10 years ago, both of these groups got together to work to stop Alzheimer's disease. And here we are 10 years later. So we went to Washington with Jeff to meet with Ed Markey and really to congratulate Ed and Chris Smith and all the other people in Congress that have been champions. Not all have, but those that have, we went to congratulate. And at the same time, Senator Markey was kind enough to congratulate us on our progress. So that's what this video is about. It's really talking about both efforts combined together to move ahead in the battle against Alzheimer's.
And I don't think you said that Jeff is our chairman.
Jeff is our chairman and founder. That's right.
Is not only the founder, but the chairman, the current chairman of Cure Alzheimer's Fund. So let's go ahead and watch this video, which just runs a few minutes, and then we'll get back to talking about specifics of what we do in Washington.
Thank you.
having me with you today.
Well, it's a pleasure, and I'm here to just brief you on what we're doing with Alzheimer's. First of all, I want to thank you for your outstanding support of our activities over the last 10 years. Your leadership in the Congressional Task Force on Alzheimer's and your sponsorship of the National Alzheimer's Project Act and your multiple activities that have supported the Cure Alzheimer's Fund. We honor you for that.
Thank you so much. My mother passed away from Alzheimer's. Everyone who has an Alzheimer's patient in their family knows how profound that is. And I've been working since she passed away in 1998 towards raising awareness here in the United States Congress. I created the Alzheimer's Task Force back then. But ultimately, our goal has to be to find the cure for Alzheimer's. And so thank you for all of the work you've done in creating an environment where the cure for Alzheimer's is now something that is increasingly on the minds of every American.
Yes, it's also getting closer and closer. Our focus has been on one thing, to find a cure, because that's the core problem. And so over the last 10 years, we've been very successful in bringing this research to the point where we're really on the verge of moving to a new stage.
Well, I think that our goal should be, and you are the leaders in this, is that we reach a day where children have to turn to the history books to find that there ever was such a disease as Alzheimer's. And we can do it.
Yep.
If we can put a man on the moon, and that's what President Kennedy challenged America to accomplish when I was a boy, well, the next mission is to the mind.
Right.
Because that's the last uncharted territory on Earth, the minds of human beings. And this effort to find the cure is something that I think is going to increasingly be driven by the kinds of research that you are helping to foster.
That's true. And I would say our moonshot is the next stage we're about to enter into. We just completed the first ever whole genome sequencing of Alzheimer's disease ever done. We now have a wonderful database of basically all of the genes of Alzheimer's. And we're now moving into kind of the final stage, which is what we call genes to therapy. So we've identified 20 of the most important Alzheimer's genes. And gene by gene, we are now developing therapies to stop them from doing what they're doing. And so that's our next phase, and that should result in substantial therapies.
Well, that is fantastic. You know, research is medicine's field of dreams from which we harvest the findings that give hope to families that there will be a breakthrough. And what you're doing is putting together all of these clues through the mapping of the genetic code that will give us an opportunity to have the smartest people in America, in the world, then find that breakthrough that gives hopes to families all across the planet.
Yeah. Well, what we have done is we've developed what are called intervention points. Alzheimer's progresses in stages, and so there are various stages where you can intervene. So each of these points is where we're focusing on developing a therapy. And I think that will really make a difference for researchers around the world, because they will now know these intervention points. And our activities are now supported by over 20,000 families. Wow. Give you an idea of the number of people that are supporting what we're doing. So we're very excited. We're very excited.
Well, you know, in the same way that we created a team to eradicate smallpox, to find the cure for polio, that's what you're doing right now.
Yep.
And you need it to be as broad and deep as is possible, and I just can't congratulate you and thank you enough for all of the work which you do.
Well, thank you very much for your
So that's a nice setup for what we're going to be talking about And now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of what we actually do in Washington. And I was just thinking during that video, thank God for Senator Markey. I mean, I don't just think how bad off we'd be if he hadn't been championing Alzheimer's.
That's true. And a point to be made there, he's not alone.
Right.
He represents others who care a lot about this. And we'll talk later about the fact that, well, if that's true, why aren't we making more progress there? But just to give him and others who've campaigned so hard for this their credit, that's absolutely true.
Right. So let's talk about what Cure Alzheimer's. There's quite a number of things that we actually do in Washington. Phil is our point man down there. But Tim, do you want to start with an overview of the different sorts of things we do, and then we can kind of get into each one of those things individually?
Sure. The first thing we don't do is lobby for funding, direct funding for Cure Alzheimer's Fund. What we do is advocate for more funding in general through the National Institutes of Health for basic research, and we work with a broad range of other organizations to do that. The other thing we do is to provide advice and counsel to Congress and the administration, and Phil can be more specific about that, but that's the broad picture.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think, as Tim said, we're not down there saying, oh, Cure Alzheimer's needs this money. Cure Alzheimer's is based on the model that we have attracted the best and brightest scientists in America. So our thought is, if there's more money available for research, money will go to the researchers we support because they are on the cutting edge. They have the innovative ideas to reach these goals. So what we do is down in Washington, we are advocating and raising awareness about Alzheimer's disease and the need for increased funding. And the way we do that is we meet regularly with congressional staff. As a matter of fact, this morning I was talking to some of the staff about this bills that are, before a bill gets introduced, the staffs and the representatives and senators will come up with the idea and say, hey, we're thinking of doing this in the Alzheimer's space. Is this a good idea, bad idea? So they'll reach out to us to talk about research ideas. So we have an opportunity at the early point to help sort of shape legislation toward what we think are the best ideas in research. We meet with the administration staff because once the bill becomes a law, the administration then implements that. So we meet with the administration, meeting National Institutes of Health, Health and Human Services, even offices you may not have even heard of, and I'll use the acronym to tell you what it is, OSTP and right. DOPPER and NSF, which means the Office of Science and Technology Policy in the White House, which is doing the President's Brain Initiative we're going to talk about, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, which is working on brain. So all these different government organizations are dealing with Alzheimer's. And so we meet with them, we talk to them to help shape the research agenda moving forward. And the way we do that is we have meetings and we'll have briefings.
Right.
And we work with other organizations. Some of them, there's one called LEAD, which is Leaders Engaged on Alzheimer's Disease. It's a coalition of about 73 organizations, some research, some care. Mm-hmm. That get together once a month to talk about Alzheimer's issues, what's going on with policy, what's going on with funding, what's going on in the private sector. We work with them. We work with Us Against Alzheimer's. We work with the Alzheimer's Association, the American Brain Coalition, Friends of the NIA, which is Friends of the National Institute on Aging. So we're involved with all these groups, and we'll have events on Capitol Hill so staff and members of Congress come in, and we can say, this is what's going on in Alzheimer's. This is good. This is bad. What you read in the paper, this is what's true, this is what's not true, because it's such a devastating disease that people want hope, and they want to have hope, and they'll read in the newspaper, oh, this trial just failed. That's too bad. We're not making any progress. And we explain why that happened. Or they'll say, I just read this thing that there's a cure tomorrow. How do I get in on that? And we explain that's not true.
So let me ask a process question. If they're asking for advice on kind of which direction to go broadly in some of these research questions, you're not a scientist. How does that happen? Do they ask you a question and then you go back to Tim and then Tim goes to Rudy, the chair of our research consortium, and we kind of then...
That's exactly how, and it's funny, I have two young daughters and they often say to me, Dad, what do you do? And I say, I'm curing disease. And they go, no, Rudy's curing disease. What are you doing? And I explain, then that's what happens. So a perfect example is the phone call today we had about the 21st Century Cure Bill, which is a bill in the House is talking about of sort of streamlining the process to help discovery get to cure faster. So they called and asked a number of questions. I reported to Tim, and we're going to have a phone call, emails with our research consortium to find out, all right, what do you guys like, what don't you like, and I report back. So that way, it's a streamlined process.
That's really exciting.
I'm not making the science decisions.
you're not just
throwing a dart on the wall.
No, I'm not saying, hey,
I think we should go for town now.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
So that's really pretty amazing, because we're a very lean and mean organization, and there's not a lot of hierarchy, as we've shown, you know, many times in this program. So it's really exciting that we can go from congressional policymakers and White House policymakers through you, and then through Tim, and basically right to the scientists.
It's seamless. We'll probably have an email exchange or a phone call beginning of the week. And we'll get these, you know, reports back to the committee staff within a week. We'll have a report back to them of what our researchers think are good ideas, bad ideas, things like that. It's that quick. It's that efficient. So much like the research funding that Cure Alzheimer's done, which is fast and focused, the policy work we do is fast and focused as well.
Is that happening on a weekly basis, or is it kind of like there's a few weeks a year where there are big questions like that that come up, and then...
Yeah, it's sort of, there's the fits and starts part. I mean, it's busy now. I'm sure everybody knows as they read the paper that the fiscal year 2015 budget is supposed to be wrapped up by Thursday. So it's a little more busy now. It's the end of the session. But after this week, it'll quiet down a bit till Congress comes back until January. But it never stops, because when Congress is, you know, in their district and working, they might not be in Washington, they're in their district meeting. So that's an opportunity for us when Senator Markey, Senator Warren are in Massachusetts to meet with them, meet with their staff, explain what's going on,
right,
have them visit. At one point, they're going to come visit Rudy's lab, things like that. So, but yeah, there are the busy periods when legislation's happening.
So Tim, let me ask you a question, because I'm now thinking as a supporter of Cure Alzheimer's Fund, I'm not just a staff member, I'm also a supporter. I'm also the first client. I want to know, you know, we've said so many times on this program and so many other venues that when people give a dollar or $100 or $1,000 to Cure Alzheimer's Fund, that is a dollar. For every dollar, that's one whole dollar that's going to research. It's going directly to research. And that's because our founders and our board members cover all our administrative costs. So let's make sure that people understand how that fits into the policy work. Is some of that dollar going to our work in Washington, or is Phil's salary and the other costs in Washington also covered by our founders? Yeah, that's a good question, and we want to be very clear about that, that all administrative costs, including Phil's modest fee, is covered by our founders and board members. So when people make contributions to Cure Alzheimer's Fund, third-party people that aren't founders or board members, all of that money goes directly to research. At the same time, as we said in the opening, we feel very strongly that as valuable as our contribution is to Alzheimer's research, we can't do it alone. So we need to be players in this scene. And we don't want to use the resources that others give us for research, mm-hmm. but we want to use our own resources to be as effective as we can to leverage those efforts so more money in general gets to basic research and to Alzheimer's specifically.
I know I'm going to sound like a booster here, which I am, but I don't mean to be. I just think it is really terrific and kind of amazing that I'm giving a dollar or $1,000, or in my case, many more than $1,000, to Cure Alzheimer's Fund, and all that money is going directly into research, into research labs, which we have talked about before. And we're getting the policy side. I'm getting the policy side for free. It really comes along.
That's right.
In the package. I also thought maybe it would be useful to turn this around and say, what if for some reason, some legal reason or some mandate, you know, from the board or something, what if we weren't allowed or we didn't do any work in Washington? What would we be giving up? That might be an interesting way to answer, mm-hmm. a question to answer that kind of helps explain to people why it's so important.
Well, I think one of the things we'd be giving up is collaboration with other Alzheimer's organizations. Mm-hmm. That's where we meet on common ground. We work together very closely with other Alzheimer's associations in this advocacy role. And it's much more helpful if we go to congressional offices or to the administration as an Alzheimer's group rather than an Alzheimer's organization. That's much more effective. So if we weren't doing this, we wouldn't be in that group, and there would probably be other fewer members of that group. And we can help influence the message, the policy that is brought then to Congress or to the administration by being a part of that.
And I think the other part of that too is if we don't tell Congress what we think is a good idea, we don't tell the administration what we think is a good idea, they're going to tell us.
Right.
It's going to happen.
Yeah.
I mean,
someone's going to decide.
The government right now is spending $500 million, $550 million a year on Alzheimer's research. If we're not telling them what we think is the most effective research, they're going to tell us. Mm-hmm. And then we're at we lose our opportunity to shape that.
Right. So we feel like we have some good ideas, and we might as well find a way to get them in there. Let's talk about some of the specific things we are involved with the government. There's two examples of real partnerships that are going on. Tim, do you want to start, and then maybe Phil can speak?
Sure. Let's put some bones on this vague concept of partnership or collaboration. There are two ways that we work with the government specifically. One is that we fund innovative, creative, proof of concept type of research. Then we look for a big partner to take those good ideas forward. And the reason that we need to do what we need to do is because they need to see the kind of data that they can then fund larger projects with. And that data doesn't get created unless somebody like us comes and funds it on the front end.
The NIH is not in the risk-taking business.
No, the National Institutes of Health funds basic research, and without that allocation, the basic research would dry up in this country, and it is imperiled because it's getting less and less money all the time. But it's still the largest source of basic research in the country. And we can add to that by taking even riskier, more innovative, more creative approaches to research to fund it. So there are two examples, let's be specific. One is the follow-on example, wherein the federal government will take a project that we've funded and shows proof of concept and says, wow, you're right, that is a great idea. We're gonna put more money behind that. And a really good example of that is a project that we've funded over the last about 8 years, and we've put probably about $700,000 into it. It's called a gamma secretase modulator, and what that does is slow the production of A-beta. A-beta is a critical actor in the pathology cycle for Alzheimer's. And we're learning now, the field is learning now, I sound like a scientist, I'm not, but the field is learning that if we can interrupt that A-beta production right in the beginning, it's potentially a preventative, just like a statin is for heart disease. And this gamma secretase modulator potentially has that kind of reach and that kind of clout to help prevent the disease before it really gets rolling, as it starts its pathology when people are in their 20s or 30s. So the NIH recognized the value of this project about 2 years ago. And on top of the $700,000 that we've put into it, they're now putting in upwards of $10 million to move it fast track into drug development. Well, we could never do that, but that's a good example of a kind of a follow-on partnership where we prove the value, they pick it up and drive it to market if they can.
And to put a few names on that, because we've talked about the scientific aspect of this a couple times on these programs, that's Steve Wagner and Rudy Tanzi's partnership.
Correct. They Steve Wagner at the University of California at San Diego, and they've been working on this for about 10 years with other collaborators, that's right. The other example is a direct partnership right out of the box. Not a follow-on, but a collaboration that's agreed upon in the beginning. And a good example of that is our whole genome sequencing, which we've referred to, we've had other webinars on. And that's essentially identifying all of the genes that affect risk for Alzheimer's. Mm. And it's done in a very high technology way. We partnered with the National Institute of Mental Health, which is one of the institutes of the National Institute for Health, NIH. To do that project. And altogether, it costs almost $10 million to do. But we put in, Cure Alzheimer's put in $5.2 million. NIMH put in $4 million. And those pots went to very specific but different things that were easy for both partner to fund. So that's a good example of a studied partnership right out of the box. The other is more demonstrating the value of the project, us taking the risk, de-risking it, NIH saying, you're right, that's a great idea, let's pick it up.
And let me just say, sure. On the NIMH one, that is the only Alzheimer's-related, genetic-related grant that NIMH does.
Really?
Yeah, so if we, what you asked earlier, well, if we're just not down there, if we sort of let things just happen through osmosis, what happens? Well, there is the potential that we lose that NIMH funding.
Yeah.
But we're down there and explaining how this helps not only Alzheimer's, but helps the mental health community. They see the value of it. But in these tight budget times, things like that, we're down there advocating to protect those sort of investments so that we can get things done we wouldn't otherwise be able to do.
So this is amazing because I wasn't there at the beginning of Cure Alzheimer's Fund, but I know the history, going back to the beginning, as you were talking earlier, this was part of our big goal, was we're going to start this private organization. We're never going to be huge. We're never going to be on the scale of the federal government, but we're going to try to leverage the important smart work that we do and bring the federal government in for some partnerships and let them take our proof of concept.
Right.
And that's actually happening. That's not just we're not just blowing smoke. No. That's actually happening.
And let me pick up on that. I'm glad you used the word leverage, because that's one of the key success markers that we use. Are we doing a good job as an organization? And we look at the factor of leverage. We look at the factor of number of papers published, references and citations and all of that, the sort of typical markers for research organizations. But we're concerned about the leverage. And what do I mean by that? I mean that we have invested something on the order of approaching $30 million in research in our 10 years. At the same time, that research has given rise to, has generated another roughly a little bit more than $40 million from NIH and others that picked up those projects. So together, we have put more than $65 million against Alzheimer's during this period that probably wouldn't have been there had we not done what we were doing.
Let me ask you what might be a tricky question, because there may be stuff you don't want to say publicly, but presumably these are not the only two partnerships we want to be having. There must be stuff that's either in the works or things that we're hope for. Can you speak to future partnerships that, or either in general or specific, the type of thing we're hoping to keep
sure.
this leverage
with? I mean, all of the science we invest in, we believe when we do it, has the potential for that kind of leverage.
Right.
Now, it turns out that doesn't happen. Not everyone is a winner. You can't win every hand. But
part of what we do is we take risks, and we know that some of those things are going to fail.
But we've got a pretty high, to mix metaphors, we've got a pretty high batting average. And one of the projects we're embarking upon now, Jeff mentioned in the video, which is our Genes to Therapies project. And this is taking all of those genes that the project I mentioned before, the whole genome sequencing that identified all the genes for Alzheimer's. Now we're looking at, okay, now we know who the players are. What do they do? Genes to Therapies is to understand what of those candidate genes, what do they do? What proteins do they make? How do they affect the biological pathways? What's their role in the pathology? This is a multi-year big deal. Right out of the box, a good estimate is it's about a $50 million project for us.
Wow.
And we will be farming these genes out to experts all over the world to ask their help in identifying what these genes do. And that's an area where we are pretty sure, given our innovation and given our investment, that we're going to be able to attract some help from any number of these agencies that Phil talked about in the federal government, as well as other investors in research.
So your thinking is that we will pay part of that 50, we'll pay all of it if necessary, but we're hoping that we can bring in partners for that part
and
of that 50.
Another key concept here, this is pulling way back to the very general. There's no doubt that Alzheimer's will be conquered. There's no doubt about that. The question is when. And when has to do with money and how many partners can afford to be working on this at the same time.
Right.
So, if we stayed in business over the next 10 or 15 years and picked away at it at the level that we can and we're really successful at raising money, we could make a significant contribution over that time. But one of our goals is to get as many other people, organizations, people, the federal government involved in this so that we can work in parallel, not in sequence, and stop this disease sooner rather than later. So it's a game of resources and time, and the more of one, the less of the other. So this Genes to Therapies project is a perfect example of that, and we're working hard to forge those partnerships with the government and others to help us get this achieved.
Great. Do you want to add to that, Phil?
Yeah, I think in one of the things, some other things that are sort of in the pipeline, I mentioned the 21st Century Cures Bill that's coming out of the House. There is then also Senator Warren, Elizabeth Warren from Massachusetts, is thinking of introducing a bill to change the way NIH is funded. So under the government, we're not going to get too in the weeds on this, but there's caps on how much you can spend on everything. Think of it as your household budget. You have mortgage, you have insurance, you have food, and you're like, all right, we're not going to spend more than this much on going to vacation somewhere. And so that's the cap. So you try to get under that. So in the government right now, there's a cap on what we can give to NIH. So she's coming up with a bill to change that cap to get more money to NIH. So we're working with her on the drafting of that and sort of discussing things and giving ideas. And then a big one with Rudy's recent discovery of Alzheimer's in a dish is the President's Brain Initiative, which is a goal to unlock the brain. The brain is the largest organ in the body. It's the least understood. You know, it controls everything. We don't know what it's doing. So the administration is set up with an idea to unlock the secrets of the brain. And it's tool development right now. How do we understand the brain? And they think the Alzheimer's in dish could be a great tool to use to not only understand Alzheimer's, but Parkinson's and ALS and other sort of neurodegenerative diseases. So, you know, those are things that are happening that it's much like a band. A band gets popular and you say, oh my God, an overnight sensation. But you don't know the work they've done for the last 20 years playing in garages.
Right,
so
right,
it's the same thing here. When we, if there's an announcement that Senator Warren's bill gets passed by Congress, and we're like, wow, what a great idea that came out of nowhere. But there's all this work that
of
goes
course.
On behind it.
Of course. And we just, let's not gloss over, not that you did this, yeah. but let's go back to Alzheimer's in a dish because that's something that's really significant that's happened in our organization. Tim, do you want to talk, just kind of give an overview about the breakthrough that just happened? It was featured on the front page of the New York Times.
Yeah,
that
Rudy, it was. And without getting too deeply in the science, which, by the way, I can't do, the highlights are that, number one, it demonstrated again, as has been done a couple of times very recently, that we can use this stem cell development, essentially, to much more rapidly test potential therapies, test drugs, in a petri dish as opposed to in mice models. Mouse models take 6 to 9 months even just to get started. You can do something in the petri dish, test drugs running it through this petri dish to see if they have any effect on human stem cells that are taken from the skin, not embryonic stem cells, but skin cells which are then turned into stem cells. Put in a petri dish creating essentially the Alzheimer's brain in this petri dish. Then you can run candidate drugs, either existing drugs that you think you might be able to reposition, which would be a huge home run because FDA has already approved them. So you can do repositioning of running these drugs through the petri dish in a matter of weeks, in some cases a matter of days, rather than months. So the economic savings and the efficiency in that tool are just huge, just mind-boggling. The other point that Alzheimer's in a dish demonstrated, the article that was in Nature that Rudy and his colleagues published, Duke Kim from Massachusetts General Hospital, was the definitive proof of the role of A-beta in the pathology. This has been debated for a long, long time. And the debate has largely been put to bed in terms of saying it's a very important component. It's not the only component.
Right.
The three biggies are A-beta, tau, and inflammation. And it takes all three of those to create Alzheimer's.
And people may have heard of A-beta otherwise as amyloid or plaques.
Correct.
Really, we're talking
Correct.
About the same thing there.
And each one leads to the other, and again, without getting into much detail. But what this series of experiments, absolutely incontrovertibly demonstrated was the essential role of A-beta in creating that cascade, that stream that creates Alzheimer's disease, which takes us way back to our earlier discussion 15 minutes ago about that gamma secretase modulator that Steve Wagner at the University of California has been working on, because what it does is hit very directly the aggregation of that A-beta to stop that cycle before it gets started. So it doesn't do much good, we have found out through other tests of other drugs that were similar, but applied much later in the pathology. Now if we take that same technique, modify it a little bit, apply it earlier in the pathology, it works. So that's all to say, what you mentioned, that article in the New York Times, did two powerful things. It brought us closer to much faster, more efficient testing of drugs, both existing and potential. And it also demonstrated conclusively that role of A-beta in that disease cycle.
And in the policy end, we take that and we'll go down and introduce the Alzheimer's to a dish to congressional staff and administration staff. We'll bring Rudy down and he'll meet with staff. We'll do a briefing for folks so that we're telling them the good news that is happening so that they can then say, all right, if we're going to decide on funding for Alzheimer's research, all right, oh, I heard about this DISH thing. That seems interesting. Could we give more money to that? If we give money to that, how can it be leveraged like Tim talked about? So we're down there in front of them saying, these are the things that are happening today. These are real. These are things you can get behind that are successful, you know, that have been proven to work.
Great. And I'm so excited by this breakthrough. I wish we could talk about it more, and we'll no doubt be revisiting it in future programs. But we have some more to talk about. We want to give people, now that we've really successfully dived into the details of what we do in Washington, we want to step back and give people an overview of where we are with the state of things, particularly in Washington and generally with Alzheimer's disease and how we're doing in fighting it in this country. So there's some good news and some bad news, and we have a couple slides that are illustrating that. Phil, why don't you start with kind of going through, some of this we've already talked about today, right. But let's talk about the good news about how our fight against Alzheimer's.
And I'll start with the bottom, sort of moving up. And sure. This is good news, but we're going to talk about this more in depth in the bad news, because it is bad too. There has been increased funding for Alzheimer's from fiscal year 2012 to fiscal year 14, because fiscal year 15 hasn't been decided yet. Alzheimer's was up 12.52%. It was the only disease that was ranked that had a double-digit increase. So we moved up to $500 million. Now, there's bad news we'll talk about because we need $2 billion a year, but there has been increased attention, awareness, increased funding for Alzheimer's research. We talked about the Brain Initiative. I think the other thing, it's called the National Alzheimer's Project Act. So that was a bill that was introduced by then-Congressman Markey. That was signed by the president, passed by Congress the end of 2010, signed into law at the beginning of 2011 by the president, that sets up a national plan to cure Alzheimer's. And the government has come out and said, we will cure or effectively treat Alzheimer's by 2025. For the first time ever, we put a date on it, and we put research as goal number one. I often say to my kids and the people I work with, if you can't measure it, you can't control it. Until you put a price tag on it, until you put a date on it, it's not real. The government put a date on this and said, by 2025, get it done. And for the first time ever, research was the first goal. We're going to do this through research. Mm-hmm. And that, and out of that, there is an advisory committee that meets with private sector individuals. And we go to the meetings all the time. Representatives from all the government agencies that meet quarterly to talk about the national plan, to write up the plan and say, this is our plan. This is how we're going to meet that goal of curing the disease.
So that sounds like good news.
It is good.
Are we ready to go to the bad news, or do you have anything else?
Yes, because there's a lot of bad news out there, and people know the bad news. So I think we can go to the bad news. I mean, one thing is, there's a lot more people with Alzheimer's.
Right.
Okay? And the cost of Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's as a disease will bankrupt America. Other diseases won't. I mean, there's a slide up now that shows the number of people getting Alzheimer's, and it shows the cost to CMS, which is the Center for Medicaid, Medicare Services. So that's the government funding of it. That doesn't include all the private insurance, self, any of that. That's just what government is spending to treat Alzheimer's. And if you look at the chart, and nobody can see it, and that's the visual we want to create, that big red part is the cost of care. And the little yellow-orange part down the bottom that's pretty much impossible to see is the research budget. Because the cost of care right now is, the cost of research right now is about $500 million, as I said. Mm-hmm. We're currently spending $2 billion or so on care.
And
$200 billion. Yeah, I get the number wrong.
100 there,
yeah. Yeah, $200 billion on care and $500 million on research. And that gap will continue to increase as more people get older and get Alzheimer's. So until we ramp up our funding of research, we're going to be spending all our money on care, and it's going to bankrupt us.
Okay, so let's stop and just make sure that we get this point across, and we've done it many times in this program, but still, it is one of the essential points to make. And Tim, we'll kind of let you put this in your own words. We are currently spending $200+ billion on care for people who are living with this unfortunate disease, and meanwhile, to fight it, the federal government is spending a mere $500+ million research to actually stop the disease. So there's something just way out of whack there. And we know that $200 billion is going to go up and up. What's it projected to be in the next generation?
You can look at the chart.
It's a trillion by 2050.
Yeah, by 2050, it's a trillion. And the easy way to remember this, if you can't remember the numbers very well, is 400 to 1. We're spending 400 times what we're investing. And obviously, that's not a sustainable ratio. We can't continue to do that. I think if we look at the next slide, the next bad news slide, what we'll see is that most of the major other diseases are going down in their mortality rate. Alzheimer's is going up significantly. Now, there's some relationship between the amount of money that is spent trying to deal with the disease and the result, because these other diseases have had many more resources over the years put into them than Alzheimer's has. And the last thing, let me say quickly, the last thing in the world we want to do is get into a disease fight here. All of these diseases are worthy of much more money than they're getting. There's just no question about that. But in terms of economic impact and in terms of the long-term suffering of the population, I think you cannot argue against the fact that Alzheimer's is woefully underfunded. So we're not trying to take anything away from anybody else, but we are trying to raise the profile of this imbalance, of this unsustainable ratio,
right,
and try to correct that.
And the worst part, from my point of view, the part that really gets me upset is that, you know, we talked about how Cure Alzheimer's Fund started 10 years ago. We talked about how the Congressional Task Force started around then also. We have known this is coming. None of this is a surprise. I think some people may read about this and go, wow, where did this suddenly come from, all these cases of Alzheimer's? And yes, the numbers have gotten bigger and bigger each year. And for people who didn't know it was coming, it's shocking to them. But I wrote my book, The Forgetting, 13 years ago. I was researching it for years before that. And I was just listening to what other people were telling me. I wasn't on the cutting edge of this. Everyone in the Alzheimer's community has known that these numbers were coming for all that time. And yet, we just haven't been spending the money. We haven't been getting ready to spend more money on the federal level for more research.
By nature, government is a reactive instead of proactive entity. And that's a problem. So they react to things. And a couple of things with Alzheimer's was, unfortunately, at start, you know, not even that long ago, maybe, you know, just 13, 15 years ago, people thought it's just a part of getting older, that if you get older, you're going to get the disease, and not realizing that it's a genetic disease like other genetic diseases are. It's not just a part of aging. So we had to sort of change the dynamic around it. One, we had to raise awareness of this as a genetic disease, which
right,
we're doing. Two, we didn't really have the tools back then to sort of make these advances in genetics and unlock the Alzheimer's genome. So there's a number of things happening. One, we now have the tools. Two, we now have the awareness. But now government's starting to react to the crisis because they can see the chart that is going to bankrupt them. So it's sort of a confluence of agendas and issues and attention coming together to focus. And now the big push is for increased research funding.
And isn't it also a matter of political will? I mean, I can get very angry at the government, and I can get angry at people who are in charge of, you know, who have really control the levers of power of government for not putting more money into this. But ultimately, we live in a democracy. Our president and our congressional leaders are doing what we tell them to do.
Right.
Or what we tell them is our priority about who we want to vote for.
Exactly.
And we haven't been saying it loud enough. I mean, isn't that is it part of it?
Absolutely true. It's true that you get, you know, the old idea is if you don't have a seat at the table, you're on the menu. So if you're not down there advocating, they, you know, government will say, well, if Alzheimer's is so bad, if we're not hearing from people, it really can't be that bad. And I mean, I'm exaggerating to make the point that they know it's bad. But yeah, you have to be down there telling them that it's bad. You have to be down there advocating and saying this is the impact on us and our families. They need to hear from people. They need to know they have limited resources. The budget's constrained. It's going to get even more constrained next year. And there's a number of things to spend it on. So we have to advocate within those constraints to say this is a wise use of your money. This is going to help you save money. If we can save money at Medicaid and Medicare, that's money that can be then spent on other things. So yeah, there needs to be the political will to get in there and advocate as citizens, to go down there and tell people this is important.
And Tim, this is interesting because you were saying earlier that we can't really do the science properly without doing the public policy role. But there's a third piece to that, which is our communications efforts, which is we really can't do either one of those things without the American people knowing, hopefully more and more of them knowing how important is what we're doing, and helping them communicate back to us by supporting us, communicate directly with Washington about how important this issue
is.
That's correct.
Government's job is sorting out competing interests. And there isn't a single congressional office or administrative office that we go into where someone says, Alzheimer's isn't important. we shouldn't fund that. Everybody says it's important.
Right.
But we're up against a number of competing interests. And as Phil says, government is reactive. And so it's the most immediate, most obvious threat often that gets the attention. I think a good example right now is Ebola. Government is just funding $5 billion for Ebola prevention. Well, you can understand that. It's contagious. It's a terrible disease. It has the potential of being an epidemic, not only here in the United States, but abroad. So you can understand the fast reaction to that. Unfortunately, what we haven't been able to compel people to understand is that Alzheimer's is also an epidemic, and it's even more predictable than Ebola or some of these other diseases.
Right.
More predictable. Look at that chart we just showed. We know where those numbers are going.
Absolutely.
And if we do nothing, that's where those numbers are going to go or get worse. So it's a classic pay me now or pay me later problem. The counter to that is, unfortunately, that's not really the way our government works. It doesn't often invest for the future. It invests for right now, for those compelling needs that overcome everything else on the immediate future. And so, back to your point, you're right. We all have to do a better, louder, screechier job of crying out the danger of this disease and what it's going to do to individual families and patients,
right,
but also to the country through the economics of it.
Right. So let's talk about what people can do, because this is a perfect setup for that question. Let's assume for a moment that we've been somewhat convincing in our discussion here, and that people are wondering, what do we want them to do? If they've got a few minutes to spend on this issue, if they've got a few dollars to spend on this issue, what are we urging them to do? It's probably a number of things, but I
want to start by asking Phil to address the first question on the screen.
Okay.
Which is call your representative. Now, you know, everybody says that. They all say it on all these kind of public policy issues. And most people think that can't be very effective. Me writing one letter, that can't be very effective. But Phil, talk about that a little bit.
It's very effective because, as you mentioned, David, it's a political entity. You know, government, they're our elected officials. And I tell you, I worked in Congress. I worked on Beacon Hill, Massachusetts, which is the state legislature in Massachusetts. And you want to hear from people. You want to know what's going on in your district. So people need to call up and say, this is how Alzheimer's is impacting me. You know, I have to take time off from my work to take my parent or grandparent to their appointments. Or my mother is caring for my dad, and this is impacting her at an advanced age. They want to hear those human stories because government, it's a trillion-dollar organization. It's a big, huge thing. And you lose the people in it. You lose the personal aspect of it. So hearing from constituents is important because it puts a human face on those things. And they need to hear these things. They're very busy. They've got a lot of issues to address. So they need to keep hearing the drumbeat of Alzheimer's research is important. Alzheimer's research is important. And tell them why it's important to you. Tell them about your personal connection to it. It goes a huge distance because they want to hear these things. The more they hear it, the more it will bubble up.
What's best, a call or a fax or an email or a...
You know, any and all sort of thing. You know, it's they're very busy. Staff are very busy. And you want to talk to people and you can, you know, or like I talked about, like when Congress is in what they call recess or district work period, when the representatives and senators are in their districts, you can go to their town meetings.
Yeah.
And say, hey, I want more Alzheimer's funding, you know, and give me a name. Write them a letter, send an email in. Now, if you send an email, you can easily call up and say to them, who does Alzheimer's in your office? And they'll give you a name, and you direct it to that instead of the general one. But you can just write a letter to the office and say, I care about Alzheimer's research. And that all gets logged, the number of people who wrote, where they're from, what they're talking about, things like that. So it all gets logged.
Let's say I approach my congressman or woman, and when he or she is home for recess, and I tell them my personal story and why Alzheimer's is so important to them. How should I follow up? When should I follow up? Should I try to call them 6 months later? Should I be doing it every week? I mean, how often?
You know, it was, I can't remember now who was the Supreme Court Justice who said it, but he had the great line, I can't define pornography, I can only, you know, tell you when I see it.
Right, right.
So it's like, I can't say how often is too often to call. You only get a sense that you're becoming burdensome. But if there's new information, if your parent or the person who, your loved one who's been touched by it, you know, takes a turn for the better or worse, you can reach out again.
Yeah.
You know, if there's a bill that comes up, and Cure Alzheimer's will do some of this to let you know through the social media, oh, this bill is up. Like, you know, we mentioned the 21st century cures bill. When that bill comes up, we might let people know, oh, you call your representative and say this is good, this is bad. You know, when Senator Warren's bill comes out. So there's these sort of vehicles that you can then make another contact on to say, vote yes, vote no, do the, you know, I'd appreciate if you could look at this, sort of stuff like that. So being engaged with the Cure Alzheimer's Fund on social media is a good way, too, to sort of keep aware of what's going on in D.C.
Okay. Yeah. So what else should people be doing? There's a point up here, follow Cure Alzheimer's Fund on social media. So sure. Obviously we want people to follow what we're doing.
Sure. That's exactly right. And we'll try to keep you posted on these public policy issues as well as research breakthroughs. And I think what that message really says is find a way that you're comfortable with supporting Alzheimer's research. We hope it'll be through Cure Alzheimer's Fund, but it might not be. There are other Alzheimer's organizations out there. Do some careful shopping, some comparing, and be willing to put some money behind your passion on this issue. Not only call Congress and try to get them into gear, but also help those that are committed to this kind of research. Advocate to everyone you know. When we're out on the stump and we're speaking to a group of people who obviously have a lot of concern about Alzheimer's, one of the things we say that they can do is just reach out to people who they know have it in their family. Be helpful, be supportive, take over a meal, give somebody an hour or 2 hours off. Try to be helpful. As people who are watching and listening today who are affected by this know, it's a tremendous commitment. I was going to say burden, and most people don't see it as a burden. They see it as a commitment, as an act of love, but they need help. So without spending any money, and we all know people who are in this situation, we can reach out and provide that kind of help and that kind of love.
So we have a few more minutes, and we're going to ask people to go to Facebook at Cure Alzheimer's account and send us some questions, and we'll try to ask a few. And we have a few queued up here that our producers have sent in to me. I'm looking at my screen. So here's one about whether there is a government program for people who, for patients, people who have Alzheimer's disease, for the families that are involved, to sign up and donate brain tissue to be directly a part of this research effort. Is there such a thing?
Yeah, there are. There's a number of ways to do it. One is the Alzheimer's Disease Research Centers, which are funded through the appropriations bill each year, and it's they basically call it the brain bank.
Okay.
So there are a number of brain, and I know that some of the Cure Alzheimer's Fund researchers, supported researchers, have received samples from those brain banks.
And some of them are actually in charge of those Alzheimer's disease research centers across the country. I think there are 33 of them, and they're based typically at academic institutions. And they're partially federally funded. That's another good example of leverage and partnership. And they do talk with people who would like to do that, which is a wonderful thing to do. So that's the first stop. You can just go on Google on your whatever search you use and type in Alzheimer's Disease Research Center, and you'll get their list and what they do.
And we can also, I imagine, put up a link and or a number on our Facebook page and on our website mm-hmm. to help people find that if they're not able to find it. So here's another wonderful point, which is that, and this is really so important, there are some diseases where people have the disease and they can, it may be painful, it may be going through a real ordeal, but at least they can speak for themselves. With Alzheimer's, obviously once people get into the middle stages of the disease, they can't advocate for themselves. It's gotta be other people. And that's also what's at play here. That's part of the political dynamic, is that the people who are truly affected by the disease, they can't go up to Capitol Hill and
nor can their caretakers.
Right.
Because they are involved 24/7 in taking care of the patients. That's right.
And that gets back to that point of it was originally seen as just a natural part of aging. So people are like, well, when you get older, you get it.
Right. There's a question about Rudy's Alzheimer's in a Dish discovery and whether that's going to help us get to better testing for people who are on their way to getting this disease, some sort of insight into something they don't yet have. Is there a connection there, or is it?
As a diagnostic tool, I think it's going to be less important than as a drug screening tool, and again, as the to elucidate, illuminate, understand better the basic disease mechanism. I think as a diagnostic, probably not as good.
Where are we with diagnostics, or where are we generally, we Americans and we in the science world?
Right now the holy grail really in Alzheimer's research is finding the biomarker or biomarkers. How can we find an inexpensive, accessible way to determine either the potential risk for an individual or somebody that's well on the way or already has it, that then intervention, when we get the right intervention, can be had. Right now there isn't such a one, but there's a tremendous amount of effort in many, many research labs trying to find that biomarker.
Here's a great question, and this really is connected to something I've talked to Rudy about several times on the air. I asked Rudy once in his office, you know, you're a fairly successful fundraiser for your own research compared to, you know, many other scientists out there. You're fairly well funded for what you want to do. But how much more money could you use right now if there was an open checkbook? And Rudy said to me, I'm operating at about 5%. In other words, I could use another 95%. I could multiply what I already get 20 times. I could put that to use right now and it would be
And it
effective.
Goes back to what we said earlier in this hour, that there's no question that we're going to solve this disease. The question is when. And so the more resources that are available to work parallel all these paths, the faster we're going to get to where we want to go.
So the follow-up to that is on
Let me just quickly say on that is the national plan has said we need $2 billion a year in federal funding.
Okay, good. That's where
So I'm, they have already said if we get, you know, to do what we say we're going to do by 2025, we need $2 billion a year.
Okay. So that's really the question that's being asked from, I think, someone on Facebook is, let's say we had the $2 billion. So when something amazing happens tomorrow and the congressional leadership gets together at the White House and, wow, we go from $500 million to $2 billion. Do we know how to spend that money?
Absolutely. In the national plan, there are a number of research, and they have a research summit every other year. Well, they have one every year. One is focused on Alzheimer's. The other year, it's focused on related dementias and then Alzheimer's. So it's every other year for Alzheimer's. And they have a research agenda, and they have sort of research priorities, and they're already mapped out. So much like you would in your home budget, if you say, man, if I won the lottery, you know, I'd buy a new car, I'd go on a trip, I'd do this, you'd spend that money right away. If government gave us $2 billion, it could be spent today.
Efficiently so.
Efficiently. The field is budget constrained, not science constrained.
That's the
bottom
line.
We know the science. We know the science, we just need the money.
Yeah. And that's the tragic. So the real tragedy here is that while we don't know actually how to cure the disease, we know what science we need to do to cure the disease, and our real constraint is money, and that's a horrible place to be because our knowledge is ahead of the funds we have, and that's why Cure Alzheimer's Fund exists, and that's why we're doing our policy work there. I think that's, I hate to end on a sour note, but this is a very difficult and challenging disease, and ultimately it is an unhappy situation.
David, but we should give people now real hope, not false hope,
sure,
by the kinds of things you see in the newspapers once or twice a week that here's a miracle cure. Okay, that's not going to happen. But the acceleration in the really good progress against the disease, even over the last 5 years, has been remarkable. And if we can sustain and increase that momentum in ways that Phil has described, if the federal government, through us, can step up and do what it needs to do, if we can continue to do the quality of research that we're doing and others do, we really have a fighting chance of getting to this much sooner than anybody thought.
Thank you for saying that, Tim. Thanks to both of you for all of the work you do and for being here today and talking this through. I think as a mere giver to Cure Alzheimer's Fund, every month that goes on, I feel more hopeful. Even though this is a very, you know, such a tough subject, I feel more hopeful that we are going to get there and that our message is being heard and that more people are listening to us and supporting us in one way or another, and I urge people who are watching to continue that support. We're very grateful for it. So that is all the time we have for our program today. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions about the science that we've sort of skirted, we've just touched on briefly in today's show, please post those questions on our Facebook page at facebook.com/curealzheimers. You can also go to curealz.org, which is our website where we have lots and lots of information on the research that we are funding and on who we are. Inside the Alzheimer's Lab is a production of Cure Alzheimer's Fund, a not-for-profit dedicated to supporting the research that will stop this terrible disease. Every dollar you donate to Cure Alzheimer's Fund goes directly and completely to scientific research. Its founders cover all administrative costs. The founders are Jeff Morby, Jackie Morby, Henry McCants, and Phyllis Rappaport. And we should also say, technically now, it's really the entire board that is now helping to fund the administrative costs, because frankly, they've gone up a little bit because we're getting bigger, which is a good thing. Do you want to mention the other board members so that we can give them
credit? Yes, Matthew Zulick, Sherry Sharp, and Robert Greenhill.
So thanks to both of you again. Thanks to you for watching. Thank you to Rudy Tanzi, the chair of our research consortium, not only for all the great research he does, but for this beautiful music which he composed that you're listening to right now. I'm David Shank. Until next time, thanks.